Captions in English, please. So this is the first video that starts chapter 14, which is on liquids and solids. But we will focus mainly on liquids. And about the textbook, you're expected to read only sections 14.3 and 14.4. So, interactions between molecules. So the particles in a gas are separated by large distances. So the attractive forces between particles in a gas are very weak. The particles are free to move about at random. They move in straight motion until they hit a wall or a container wall and then bounce back. And so they will spread and take up whatever space is available in the container. But that's not properties of solids and liquids. The attractive forces in liquids are strong enough to hold the particles in close contact while letting them slip and slide over one another. So they can roll around, they're packed together, but they can roll around. And water molecules then are free to move around and they will flow to take the shape of the container. So that implies the fluidity as a property for liquids. The attractive forces in solids are so strong that they hold the particles rigidly in place and they prevent their movement. So solids, you know, keep their shape because the molecules are held tightly in place. However, they do vibrate in place because, you know, as you increase the temperature, a solid, for example, may dilate and its volume may slightly increase. And that's because they vibrate, and the higher the temperature, the faster they vibrate, and then they will slightly dilate when temperature increases. And so in this chapter, we will look at the nature of the attractive forces that are responsible for the properties of liquids and solids, and then some of the properties that are related to this. So attractive forces, the nature and structure of a substance determine the type and strength of the molecular forces that operate within it. So you need to understand clearly the difference between intramolecular forces and intermolecular forces. So intramolecular forces operate within the molecules or within the fundamental units of a substance, because remember, molecules are only made of non-metals. And when we are talking about ionic compound, we are talking about units, formula units. And so the intramolecular forces are the covalent bonds. So whenever we have been talking about bonds, that's what we mean, it's intramolecular forces. So they are the covalent bonds within a molecule of a molecular substance, like made of non-metals only. And they are the forces between ions in an ionic compound. And also the forces between atoms in a metal. And so by opposition, intermolecular forces operate between the molecules of a covalent substance. So intermolecular forces. So it's inter is a prefix that means between. So it's between the molecules of a covalent substance, for example, or between the atoms of a monoatomic element, like the noble gases are monoatomic element. And it's also forces between the ions of one substance and the molecules of another. So not within an ionic compound, but between the ions of a substance and the molecules of another, like for example, when salts are dissolved in water. And so as a rule, intramolecular forces are much stronger than intermolecular forces. And so those intramolecular forces are what we have been calling bonds up to now, right? And so intermolecular forces are much weaker, but nevertheless, there is many of them, and it really changes the properties of matter. But to see the difference in strength, for example, you need 41 kilojoules. Kilojoules are units of energy, You need 41 kilojoules to break intermolecular forces in 1 mole of water to boil it. So 1 mole of water is 18 grams of water, and so that represents a mouthful of water. And so when you're trying to warm this small amount of water and try to boil it, it requires 41 kilojoules. And what you're doing is not breaking the molecule of water itself, but breaking the intermolecular forces that holds the molecule together. And then if you compare that to the energy needed to break all the HOH covalent bonds in 1 mole of water, you need to bring 930 kilojoules, so a much larger amount of energy if you plan on breaking the molecules of water themselves for the same quantity of water, 1 mole. So that really shows you the difference in strengths of intramolecular forces versus intermolecular forces. So let's go more into details on intramolecular forces. So they represent the attractions between positive and negative ions in a crystal of an ionic compound. So those electrostatic attractions between positive and negative charges. So ionic bonds, basically. Intramolecular forces are also the covalent bonds that link the atom in a network structure like that of silicon dioxide, which is a sand, or diamond, you know, the carbon-to-carbon bonds are made of covalent bonds, and these are intramolecular forces. It's also, those intramolecular forces are also the covalent bonds in molecular substances like H2O, what makes the molecule itself, the bonds between the H's and the O, and the bonds between the carbon and the oxygen, carbon dioxide, for example. So the bonds that make up the molecules themselves. And intramolecular forces are also metallic bonds, like you find in any kind of metal solid, like copper, magnesium, iron. And so the representations we have here are showing how, you know, in the molecule of water, it's that dark black line. We represent those bonds as lines. And so these are the intramolecular forces. And in the structure of diamond, it's made of carbon atoms only. And the intramolecular force is the bond between the carbon atoms, which, you know, makes the structure of diamond. And so by opposition, intermolecular forces are the attractions exerted by one molecule of a molecular substance on another, such as the force of attractions between water molecules in ice. So you recognize the same structure of ice here as in the previous slide, but this time we are talking about the intermolecular forces, which are the dashed red forces between the hydrogen of a molecule of water and the oxygen of another molecule of water. So it's between two different molecules. But that's what's holding the molecules of water together and holding them into the solid state. Intermolecular forces are also the attractions between the atoms of the noble gas elements, you know, helium through radon. You know, all those noble gases, when they are, you know, if you are reaching low temperatures enough to have them in the solid states or liquid state even, then there will be some intermolecular attractive forces that will hold them together. That's what will hold them into the liquid or solid phase. Those intermolecular attractive forces are also the attractions between molecules of one substance and molecules of another. For example, when two liquids are mixed, or a molecular solid such as sugar is dissolved in a liquid. So when you have mixtures like that and they look like an homogeneous mixture, you cannot tell that you have two substances mixed, that's typically because you have intermolecular attractive forces that are holding the molecules or the ions with the molecules together. And that's why it looks like one substance, because they are held together, the molecules are held together. And the intermolecular attractive forces are also the attraction between the molecules of one substance and the ions of another, as when an ionic compound dissolves in a liquid. So for example, when any kind of salt is dissolved in water, that those intermolecular attractive forces are what allows water to dissolve the salts and keep the ions separated and dissolve them from their solid state into the liquid water. So we will watch a crash course on liquids.